I love to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat. What seems each time I tell it, more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.
What does it mean when you ask someone, has a cat got your tongue? You've heard the expression, right? Everybody's heard the expression, has a cat got your tongue? So what do we mean by it when we say it?
You have no response to what people tell you.
Okay, so people are talking to you, expecting some sort of response, and you're not responding back, just not involved in the conversation. This expression, when Satan has your tongue, I've never heard anybody use that, so I don't know if it's inappropriate in some way or not. I think it's a real thing. It's when the tongue is a little too free and saying things it shouldn't be saying. But anyway, we'll get into that in more detail. I'm going to show you a video. This is not a pleasant video, but it's one that's very important, and it is about the tongue. But take a quick look at this.
And the air.
Months ago, I was a Christian. Through basic observation of the world around me and logical thinking, I've come to the conclusion that alongside the fact that there is no Santa Claus and there is no Easter Bunny, there is also no God. So without further ado, my name's Chandler, and I deny the existence of the Holy Spirit.
I deny God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit.
I deny the Holy Spirit and Jesus.
I deny the Holy Spirit.
The Rational Response Squad wants you to make a short video declaring your independence from the Stone Age. Shoot your video and upload it to YouTube, and we'll send you a free copy of the hit documentary, The God Who Wasn't There, on DVD. The DVD normally sells for $24.98, but it's yours free when you make and upload your video. If you already own a copy of The God Who Wasn't There, remember, it makes a great gift. Find out more at blasphemychallenge.com.
I deny the Holy Spirit, and I'm not afraid.
First of all, you can probably tell that the audience they're targeting is young people. And what they're trying to do is to get them to say that they deny the Holy Spirit, they deny God, they deny it all. That has some appeal to young people because it's a form of rebellion in a way too, isn't it? Young people might be inclined to do that kind of thing just out of a sense of rebelling against parents. The Blasphemy Challenge, even this website's had over 1 million hits. So this is not a tiny little thing going on. The people behind it, Rational Response Squad, if you visit their site, you look at what they're saying. Bottom line is what they say about Christians is, if you're a Christian, you're either stupid or you're insane or you're a fraud. That is, you're pretending you believe all this stuff to take advantage of other people. If you look at the DVD that they're promising to send people, a great Christmas gift. That DVD, it's about an hour long. I've watched a little more than 15 minutes of it and couldn't take any more. because what they're doing is they're trying to take the Bible and the story of the Bible and say why this is nonsense and why nobody should believe this. And their little thing is so full of lies. I mean, they have twisted things. There's one scripture passage that they quote, and it's pretty close to accurate, except they changed the verb tense. And it changed the meaning of the verse entirely. And then they jumped some big conclusion off that one verse that they misquoted. It's full of lies, and it's an interesting thing to watch because you, for a while anyway, as you can try to point out all those things that are wrong. But they mix in truth with it too, so that's why it makes it harder for the young people to notice what's going on and why the young people are going to be more susceptible to it than you would hope. But anyway, it's a sad commentary when people are targeting these young people and trying to get them to do this. And it's a matter of trying to get someone to say something that Satan would like for them to say. And that's Satan controlling your tongue. Does Satan have your tongue? If you're saying those things, then Satan has your tongue. I'm focusing on this one thing this morning, and that is the tongue, and using it to express something. And when we're doing, or to what extent is Satan involved in that? Before we go there, let's look at some of the questions. When things become difficult in a person's life, things become difficult in everybody's life at some point, and they become difficult in different ways for different ones of us. But when things become difficult, how do people react to that?
Why me?
Why me?
Well, sometimes they try to fix it themselves.
Try to fix it? Yeah, we're going to have to get in here. This has to be fixed. I can't go on like this. How else?
Panic.
There are lots of things in our lives that can push us to the door of panic, aren't there? What else?
Blame game.
Blame game? Well, this has to be somebody's fault. In our culture today, no matter what happens, you have to find out who's to blame. Because we're talking about the tongue and the things that people say. Why is it so hard to praise God when we find ourselves in difficult circumstances? In the minds of many people, many of us sometimes, is when things get really difficult, the feeling is I have been abandoned. Now, he has left me here, and maybe I have messed things up so badly that I'm a lost cause. And so there's no thought of praising God. Rather, it's one of complaining. I'll refer back to one of my favorite verses from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Rejoice always, pray continuously, give thanks in all circumstances. In all circumstances, give thanks. Bless him. Now, that is hard stuff. That is not an easy thing to do. But that's what he tells us to do. That's how we are going to get through those difficult situations, is in giving praise to him. I use the term Satan, and I'm going to talk about Satan today, but a large percentage of people who call themselves Christians, 40%, don't believe that Satan is a real being, that that's just a concept to describe evil in general. But why don't they believe that he's real?
I don't think there's any evidence.
Yeah, there's no evidence for it. He's not a physical being that we're going to bump into, is he? I mean, he's a spiritual being.
He may really look benevolent, but not like that.
We have these images that people have been putting out here for years and years of the devil, you know, with the tail and the horns and all this stuff. And so that looks a little bit like the fairy tale, doesn't it? This is a made-up thing for children. Some people will say that's all it is, and so it's not real because of the way we portrayed him, rather than the real threat that he is to the life of every believer.
People can't relate to the fact that the devil has anything to do with the bad things that happen.
Isn't it amazing that if a bad thing happens to somebody who's not a true believer, if something goes wrong, they're going to be quick to blame God that they don't even claim to believe in, and they would never say that the devil had anything to do with it. Remember back in the 70s, Flip Wilson's character, Geraldine?
Oh, yeah.
Geraldine, I had several famous phrases, you know, what you see is what you get. But one of the very popular, the devil made me do it. And that was very, very popular in the 70s and even has continued on, where occasionally you'll even hear that today. But why is it people kind of latched onto that? Not just believers, but people in general, a lot of people jumped right on to that phrase and used it themselves. The devil made me do it. It's part of the blame game. It's a scapegoat, isn't it? It's a way of saying, well, I'm not responsible for this evil that I did. The devil made me do it. How can Satan use godly people? Catch you at your weakest moment. How else can he use godly people?
Gossip.
Oh, so now we're getting back to the tongue. If you have been used by Satan at some point, what are the consequences? If you believe at some point that you messed up on something so badly that Satan was involved in that, that he is, in fact, he set you up, if you believe that, would you feel any weight on your shoulders because of that? If you understood that you, in fact, had been used in that situation, what effect would that have on you? All right, so yeah, there are lessons we can learn from that. But for some people, the burden is so heavy that they are crushed by it, aren't they? There are some people, they'll say to themselves, I have messed up so badly, there is no hope for me anymore.
That's why young people turn to drugs or suicides.
Makes it even easier when those situations happen for the blasphemy project to succeed with young people. All they have to be is in a little bit of a situation of some sort that is a difficult circumstance. And so there is no giving thanks, but it is a problem of, you know, I'm in a mess. And so this seems like a way to help me resolve all that. I'll just blow away all this other stuff that seems to be burdening me. Even today, we run into these situations where people are saying what the devil wants them to say in that situation. So the tongue revealing the heart, that's really what we're implying by the introduction so far, is that the tongue reveals the heart. How does that happen? How does the tongue reveal what's in your heart? In your mind, if you prefer. It kind of flows out, doesn't it? I mean, if you have stuff in there that you've been thinking about, how long does it take for it to come out in something that you say to somebody? I mean, it's going to show up somewhere in some conversation because that's becoming more and more who you are. It's influencing who you are. I'm going to show you a film clip this morning that I hope doesn't remind you of any Thanksgiving dinner that you've had or any family gathering that you've had. When families gather, for whatever reason, and we gather for all kinds of reasons, but when families gather, sometimes sparks will fly. Because even though we're family, we're different, and we see things differently. So we have all kinds of people. And you get together for a family gathering, and if the discussion goes in the direction of one of those areas where the sparks will fly, then the sparks will probably fly. This is Madam Secretary, which is a TV series. This is from the second season, episode 13. The show involves Elizabeth McCord, who is Secretary of State. Her husband, Henry, is a professor of philosophy and religion and also involved with the National Intelligence Agency. Henry's father dies. And so Henry and Elizabeth and the children go to Pittsburgh, where his father lived, and the rest of the family lives. There's a word that will pop up in here is yinzer. I don't know if you've ever heard of a yinzer. Anybody ever hear of a yinzer? Y-I-N-Z-E-R. And it's what people in Pittsburgh call themselves when they were born, raised, and stayed in Pittsburgh. They're yinzers. When I first saw this, I was wondering if it was a swear word that I needed to cut out. So I had to look it up and find out. Family is a bunch of yinzers. Except for Henry, who has moved on and moved up in the world, is married to the Secretary of State, and is a professor, and is involved in Secret Service kind of work. They've gone back to Pittsburgh for the father's funeral. Once they get there and they start putting things together for the funeral, they realize that the father has committed suicide. And most of the family then has a real problem dealing with this because, you know, here was the beloved father and he's died. And so they're trying to just get their arms around that. And now they realize that, in fact, he's just taken some pills in it all because he has been cheated in an online scam and has lost all of his money. His pension's gone. He's mortgaged the house. All the money is gone. So the children now not only have this problem of the father has died, the father has committed suicide, but he's also lost all the inheritance, so there's no money. So it's a pretty sad situation. Now, there are three scenes. I'm going to show you pieces of these three scenes. The first one is where the family is sitting around when they've realized that the money is gone. And so they sit around and discuss this, and the sparks will start to fly at this point. The second piece is where some friends of the father visited, guys he had worked with, retired with, and he still continued to play cards with, and, you know, good friends. And they've come to offer their condolences to the family, and things are really going to get heated here. The third scene is the last one, and this is where they are at the police station, and they learn what happened in the scam, and they learn that they are not going to get any of the money back. The money is lost forever. Let me introduce you to the characters. But Henry and Elizabeth. Henry is the son of the man who died. Shane is Henry's brother. He has two sisters, Maureen and Erin. Maureen is the primary character here. You're going to want to focus on Maureen. She's going to be the one whose tongue will cut loose. And Maureen's husband is there, but he's relatively insignificant.
Okay, I'll say it. Is there any way we can get back the money? You're all thinking it. Maybe not Henry and Elizabeth, but I could sure use my share.
Look, I spoke with Detective Swanstrom, and, you know, he was sympathetic, but the truth is most of these scams are perpetrated in other countries.
Business. Could you do anything, Elizabeth? Pull some strings?
I wish it was that simple.
Well, make it simple. Call the president. Say it's protocol.
The thing is that the State Department doesn't really handle these kinds of things.
What my wife is too polite to say is that what you're asking her to do is unethical.
Elizabeth is always saying she wants to help. We need help. Why can't you?
Drop it.
He just assumed he took a heart attack. Was it something else?
The truth is, he was in a bad place and he couldn't reach out for help.
What Henry means is that our dad was in a bad place because he was so sick.
Maureen, if we can't talk about how he died, then we won't be able to mourn him. Our dad took his own life.
We agreed.
No, Maureen, you insisted. I'm not going to treat this like some shameful secret. I'm not going to lie about our
father.
Can't
you keep your high and mighty mouth shut for 2 seconds? But no. Everything just has to be done your way, like we don't count.
Hey, Pot, you and the kettle are looking a little black there.
Stay out of this, Shane.
No, you don't get to decide for the rest of us what we can feel or say.
Yes, I do, because I was here every day, taking care of Mom, taking care of
Dad. I live across town. Aaron's 10 minutes away.
Yeah, but you were never here. Maybe Sunday dinners, the Super Bowl. I cleaned the toilets. I cooked the meals. I took care. You and Elizabeth breeze into town, visiting us on your book tour, waving to us from the motorcade. Just don't think that puts you in charge now, just because she can put the funeral on her credit card.
What's this now?
No, it's just a temporary fix. I'm just trying to help.
Trying to one-up all of us like usual. You know what we call her.
Queen Elizabeth.
Queen Elizabeth. Like it's a big secret. We're not stupid, Maureen.
When you took up with Elizabeth, you changed.
That's enough.
Turning up your nose at us yinzers, acting like a new man with a fancy degree and a rich wife.
You are way over the line, Maureen.
You guys are screaming so loud we can't hear the TV.
What's going on?
We're having a family discussion.
Yeah, but it's over. Come on, kids.
Hey, if it makes you feel better, we'll leave right after the funeral.
Blow into town, turn everything upside down, then blow right back out again. What else is new? And at the lowest point of his life, if he reached out to you and you turned your back on him again, that would be the worst thing. Worse than losing all his money, worse than death. So he didn't even try. Instead, he just went to sleep. And we can all say that we would have done anything to help him, that couldn't see the signs. We can say whatever we want now because it's too late. But I say he's dead because of you.
Pretty sharp tongue. But see, we're all capable of doing things like that. A sharp response to something in a heated moment. Where is that coming from? What is the source of that kind of a response? This is going to be a little different from the emphasis that you normally have when you look at the story of Job. I want to focus on Job's wife. we don't think much about her, and we remember the one thing that will pop up here is the heart of the story, where she makes a statement to Job that is particularly harsh and critical. But let's think about this character, or this woman, as we look at the story. First of all, as we look at the background in the first couple of chapters of Job, there are good times. I mean, things are really, really going well. Job is described as a blameless man, upright, fears God, worships God. I mean, he's a good man, blameless and upright. What would you think about his wife? Well, you don't know anything other than this. If you have this blameless, upright man who fears God, walks with God, what kind of wife would a man like that have? What kind of wife would you expect him to have? You would expect a godly wife. Well, in fact, we find that he's also the greatest of all the people of this area of the East. We're talking about the Iran, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, I mean, today, all that area through there. I mean, he's the greatest man in all that area. He is a very good man. He has 7 sons and 3 daughters. The sons throw feasts at their homes on a regular basis. All the children come with their families and they celebrate. So the children are all close. That's a great thing, isn't it, for parents when they have a bunch of children and the children are all close. Doesn't always happen. Get enough children and 2 of them aren't going to get along really well. But they had 7 sons and 3 daughters and they get along extremely well. Well, what kind of mother has children like that? Normally a very good mother, isn't it? I mean, somebody who has taken great interest and concern in these children. In fact, Job would consecrate them on a regular basis after they throw their little parties. He'd bring them all in and they'd worship and he'd consecrate them and making sure that everything was right with their souls. It's unlikely that the mother objected to this, right? I mean, you would not expect anything like that. This looks like a great family situation. Job was also rich. Job had 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, so that means 1,000 oxen, and a bunch of donkeys. He had great wealth. The other thing underlying that is here's a man who has all this wealth. He could have any woman he wanted. He could have as many women as he wanted. Job had one wife, and we're going to see a little bit more about that in a moment, what Job's attitude about that relationship was. So Job's wife must not have been a shrew. I mean, she must not have been too bad, because Job had the opportunity to have as many women as he wanted. And that's not uncommon in this area at this time. This is the earliest book of the Bible. So whatever Job wanted, he could have had. These are the good times. Well, then Satan comes on the scene. Satan appears before God. God says, "Where have you been? I've been roaming the earth. Have you considered my good man, Job? No one like him." Satan says, "Oh, yeah, that's no big deal." He said, "You just built a hedge around him. You've given him all this wealth. Why wouldn't he like you? And why wouldn't everything be fine? But I'll tell you what, if you let me take all the stuff away from him, he'll curse you to your face. Touch all that he has and he will curse you to your face." So now we're getting to what Satan's objective is. Satan's objective is to get Job to speak a curse against God. You think he would enjoy having you curse God? You think that would bring any delight to Satan? Do you think it brings any delight to Satan to see the blasphemy project, to see these young people deny the existence of God and the Holy Spirit? That's what he's after. He wants us, just as he wanted Job, to curse God. God says, "Okay, you can have his stuff, because I am confident that Job is mine, that Job fears me, Job loves me, and Job will respond appropriately." Well, so now the bad times are going to come because Satan's going to get involved. And so a messenger comes to Job, and I would assume his wife, but that's an assumption on my part, but she's going to be knowing this very quickly, whether she knows it the instant that Job does or very shortly after. The message is coming that, first of all, the Sabaeans, this would be people from the area of Yemen today, down below Saudi Arabia, these people have come up and they've taken the oxen and the donkeys. So all those animals and all the servants that are watching after them. Now, there had to be a lot of servants. If he had 500 yoke of oxen, as 500 teams of oxen, he probably had 500 servants to drive the teams, right? It's an assumption on my part, but probably not too far off. He had a lot of servants. Well, the servants are all killed, except the one who comes to relay the message. Now, that's bad news. This is a big chunk of Job's wealth wiped away. Well, while that servant is talking, another servant comes running up and says, your sheep and the servants tending the sheep, 7,000 sheep, and all the servants required to tend the 7,000 sheep have been killed by a fire of God from heaven. Fire has come down from heaven and destroyed the sheep and the servants. Well, now Job's wealth has really been cut. But while he is still talking, another servant comes running up. And that servant says, your camels and all the servants around you are 3,000 camels. Camels were taken by the Chaldeans. That would be in the area around southwestern Iran, near the border with current-day Iraq. So in that general vicinity. So these Chaldeans have come, and they have taken those animals and killed those servants. Now the wealth is gone. All that he had is gone. Is that enough for you to scream, Uncle? Well, it's not over. Another servant comes running up and says, your sons and daughters who were partying at your son's house have all been killed because a wind has come up and collapsed the house upon them, and they're all dead. All your children are dead. Now, we focus on Job because that's the book of Job, but Job had a wife. Job's wife was the mother of those 10 children. Job's wife has suffered through exactly what Job has suffered through up to this point. How would you handle it if everything that you own wiped away? Those family members closest to you taken away, all in one fell swoop, in a matter of an hour, because this one messenger right after another, as this one was talking, another one comes up. You're informed of these catastrophes. It's hard to imagine how a person would feel. We as men understand how close we can be with children, but a mother's relationship with a child is stronger. Can you imagine Job's wife now as this information is received? Well, Job falls on his face. We don't get the reaction of his wife, but I have to believe it's at least as strong as Job's, except for the way that Job expresses it. Job says, I came into this world with nothing, and I'm going to leave this world with nothing, and that's fine. Naked I came, naked I'll leave. No U-Haul behind the hearse as you go out, just you. Naked I came in, naked I go out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. The Lord gave it to me, the Lord has taken it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Giving thanks in all circumstances, as in 1 Thessalonians, give thanks in all circumstances. Job did it. Now, we have reason to believe, as we'll see shortly, that his wife did not. But we can have some sympathy for that because it's unlikely that we have always given thanks in all circumstances. Well, after a period of time, Satan goes back into heaven and God says, I told you so. Job didn't curse me. That's what Satan is after, is for Job to curse God. Job did just the opposite, and he blessed God. Satan says, it's only because you wouldn't let me touch him. It's also interesting, you might notice, when Satan took the children out, he didn't take Job's wife out. As you think about it, you might think that, well, that would be something that he would do, right? I mean, if he's going to attack Job and he can do everything except touch Job himself, maybe you should take the wife too. Somebody made the comment that if Satan is granted permission to take something away from you but does not, it means he has plans for it, to use it against you. Kind of a scary thought, actually. Satan gets back. God says, you weren't successful. He didn't curse me. He blessed me. Satan says, okay, let me get him. Let me attack Job's physical body. And we'll get him to curse you to your face. Getting Job to curse God is his goal. Touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face. God says, okay, just don't kill him, but you can do it. Satan then struck Job with loathsome sores. So he now has sores all over his body. This would be like having skin cancer, psoriasis, shingles on both sides of your body all at once. This is a horrible, horrible case. And no calamine lotion, no injections, there's no painkiller. You're just going to suffer through it. Then we get the verses that we remember about Job's wife. Because Job still does not curse God. Satan is losing again. Job's wife comes on the scene now, and after a period of time with all these sores and all this mess, I mean, she has nothing. All the wealth is gone. The children are gone. Now her husband is this pile of sores, oozing sores. Job's wife mocked him for being faithful to a God who would allow this to happen to them. How could he possibly hold fast his integrity? But that is how God praised Job to Satan after the destruction of his wealth and children failed to destroy him. He still holds fast his integrity. Job was steadfast in his faith. Then she proved that Satan had her tongue by telling Job to curse God and die. Telling him to curse God was to try to get him to do the very thing Satan wanted to accomplish. Telling him to die or commit suicide encouraged him to forsake any trust in God and his providence, another one of Satan's desires. The kind of confused thinking she demonstrated is often found in unbelievers and nominal believers. It takes radical faith to trust and obey in all circumstances. But Job had radical faith and did not sin with his lips by cursing God. So he rebuked his wife for trying to tempt him with such foolish thinking. Soon after the disaster, Job's friends visited with him. They did well in the beginning when they sat quietly with him and mourned with him. But then they started telling him what they thought the problem was. In chapter 19, after the first round of criticism, Job described the pain that he felt from everyone deserting him. His wife brought him further pain by avoiding him. The stench of his sores had driven away all his family. After another round of false accusations, Job's defense in chapter 31 included a description of what he believed about marriage. He viewed adultery as a dreadful crime that destroys a person's soul. Clearly, this man remained faithful to his wife, even though she did not want anything to do with him at this time. In the end, God restored Job's wealth. He even doubled the material things that he had taken away. Job was blessed with more children, 7 sons and 3 daughters, the same numbers as before. No mention is made as to who was the mother of those children. It is clear from what Job said before that if his wife was still alive, she was the mother of those children. Job was fully restored, and it is possible that Job's wife was restored as well, even though Satan had had her tongue. That should not surprise us. Peter was rebuked by Jesus when he tried to prevent Jesus from going to Jerusalem to die. Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan," because Satan had Peter's tongue. Peter was saying what Satan wanted to be said. Despite that misstep, Peter was restored. Perhaps Job's wife was restored as well. So what does all this mean for you? Satan had the hearts and tongues of many of the Pharisees. They wanted to kill Jesus and encouraged lies and deceit to accomplish it. When Jesus rebuked them in Matthew 12, he said, "Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." A heart filled with truth speaks truth. A heart filled with lies speaks lies. A heart controlled by Satan is revealed by a tongue that speaks Satan's words. As Jesus said, our words reveal our hearts. Satan's goal is to capture our hearts. And if anyone curses God, Satan has that heart. Job was steadfast. Satan did not get his tongue. Job's wife was defeated and became a tool of Satan. Satan had her tongue. God restored Peter. Did God restore Job's wife?
I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory. To tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.